Good afternoon. Please be seated. The next matter in order for hearing this afternoon is the matter of Ed Friedman et al. Versus the Public Utilities Commission. Council, I'm going to ask those who will be engaged in oral argument to stand right where you are, give us your name and the party you're representing so that we can start the official record.
Bruce LaBlanca for appellants, Ed Friedman et al.
Thank you, Mr. LaBlanca.
Jordan Coleman for the commission.
Thank you, Mr. Coleman.
Ken Farber for Central Maine Power Company.
Thank you, Mr. Farber. Mr. McLaughlin, you may proceed.
Thank you, Your Honor. May it please the court. There are multiple reasons for why this commission's order must be vacated. They can be summarized in 3 points, and then I'll come back on the details of each. Number one, the order lacks a rational basis because it's directly contradicted by specific findings and conclusions in the decision. Number two, the order is based on multiple errors of law, including shifting the burden of proof and misapplying the legal standards by excluding threats of harm from all chronic exposures over time, and by excluding threats of harm from thousands of CMP smart meters that transmit more frequently than a typical CMP smart meter. Number three, the order is not supported by substantial evidence because there is no reliable evidence for the commission's conclusions about typical smart meter exposures. Number one, on a rational basis, Commissioner Littell found, quote, credible evidence of a risk of chronic effects. He found it's possible that some of those complaining have a sensitivity that is clinically manifest. He found the record supports a reasonable supposition that there may be symptoms for some people related to the installation of smart meters. Many lay witnesses testified to the actual, not just threatened harm suffered from exposure to smart meter radiation. Commissioner Littell found much of this testimony credible. He concluded, it is an unreasonable utility practice to require the smart meters without a medical opt-out. These findings and conclusions stand unchallenged on appeal and cannot be rationally reconciled with a determination of no credible threat of harm. Number two, multiple errors of law. Both commissioners limited the scope of the legal standard. Despite finding credible evidence of a chronic risk, Commissioner Littell decided the commission can ignore this threat of harm as long as the exposure in the home is comparable to exposures outside the home. Many CMP customers, particularly those who are susceptible to radio frequency radiation or have sensitivities to it, take extraordinary measures to make their home a safe haven from RF radiation. Commissioner Littell says their concerns are real and credible, but irrelevant. And CMP is allowed to invade these safe havens. CMP can add to the threat that might be experienced outside with compulsory exposures inside the home.
Can I apologize for interrupting, but in the short time we have, can I ask you to address the preemption issue first? The FCC has set standards, and our PUC is primarily an economic regulator, as I think all have acknowledged here. Why isn't CMP's argument that preemption actually resolves this matter an argument that we should adhere to?
There are multiple reasons, the most important of which are this court has already decided the issue by inference by mandating to the PUC to investigate the safety of smart meters.
Well, you say that that's by inference, but if we look at our first opinion in Friedman, we didn't specifically address preemption. I think you'll agree with
that's
that.
That's correct.
What we said was that because the PUC had not addressed the safety issues at all, we were remanding it. We did not say that it needed to look beyond what the FCC said.
It was an issue that was argued at oral argument and in the briefs, and was impliedly decided by remand.
If we don't accept your assertion that we have made that decision, what is your best argument that preemption doesn't prevail here?
Well, the commission made the decision that it was not preempted. I understand you can overrule that, obviously. Commissioner Littell found that the FCC guidelines are woefully outdated and not relevant, particularly to the issue of non-thermal effects from RF radiation, which the FCC standards do not address.
So isn't that really your best argument on preemption, that the FCC standards have not yet addressed anything beyond the thermal effects?
That is certainly one of our strongest arguments, along with the fact that, as you said at the beginning, the commission is primarily an economic regulator. So is the FCC. The FCC is not a safety regulator and defers to the EPA, which makes the point. The EPA directly told the FCC, your guidelines do not protect people from...
But Commissioner Littell also said that those regulations, the FCC regulations, are valid. They are the law. Why doesn't that answer the question?
Well, they are the law as far as they extend, but they do not preempt a state agency from considering from enforcing its own legislative mandate to determine the safety of its utility facilities. None of the arguments that were made on the legal in the CMP's brief about case law establishing preemption apply to the circumstances of this case.
If there were a no cost opt out, would you be here today?
Yes, Your Honor.
So you would still be here. The consumer had the right to say, I don't want the smart meters. What would be the problem with that?
There would still be exposure, Your Honor, to the low-level radiation.
If I can turn it off, just as you say you want the medical accommodation, which we'll talk about a little later, doesn't that solve the problem? There's no radiation?
It may solve the problem for some, but maybe not for all.
For those who opt out, it would solve the problem, wouldn't it?
To the extent that they
opt out and not purchase it, what would be the problem?
Well, an important aspect of this case is that CMP has not tested any of its other equipment. It's not tested the exposures from the collectors. It's not tested the exposures from multiple banks of meters that people may be exposed to.
So you're talking about the system-wide stuff, not just the individual users.
Yeah, and I mean, if you're a tenant in an apartment building, if you live in a close...
Right, for other folks who haven't opted out. Can I reference you back? You referenced Commissioner Littell's statements regarding opting out and his decision there, suggesting that, in fact, he found that there was a credible threat of harm.
Yeah.
So that's supportive. But if we go to the conclusion to which both commissioners signed on to, they say, and I'm quoting, "We conclude that CMP's installation and operation of its smart meter system poses no credible threat of harm to the public or CMP's customers and is therefore safe." So regardless of whether he referenced the opt-out section in his writing separately, the conclusion which he signed on to is an unconditional approval.
My argument, Your Honor, is you can't get from his findings to that conclusion without adopting his multiple errors of law and without using the unreliable evidence about typical smart meters. He also says that his decision is based under the average typical operating parameters that CMP meters meet the contemporary safety standard. He also says safety is not litigated here for higher exposures than CMP's average typical exposures. One of my other arguments is going to be that typical means, according to CMP's experts, a smart meter that transmits no more than 234 times a day. There are 120,000, at least if you accept their own data, there's 120,000 meters out there that transmit
but
more than
the typical. The testing by trillions, which I understand has a relationship with CMP, testing showed that at 3 feet away from the transmitter, with no walls, the exposure dropped to 100,000 times lower than the FCC and ICNIRP standards.
I'm sorry, who's being quoted there?
This is Trillions, the manufacturer of the smart meters.
I don't know exactly what they're referencing, Your Honor, but the question is, what is being transmitted by CMP smart meters in the field here? And the testing that CMP's experts did was totally unreliable.
Well, and let me just take you from that point. I realize you probably reject the result and you reject the tester, but the standard before us today is whether the commission's decision was supported by substantial evidence. So this evidence is in, for better or worse, it is substantial. Why doesn't the matter stand or fall on that issue right there, that there was in fact substantial evidence that the meters were safe?
Unless the court is going to go back into the record and find a basis for rejecting Commissioner Littell's findings, I think whatever you decide has to be based in part on those findings, or can't get around those findings. And he says that his determination of safety is based on typical exposures. He's saying that if there's exposures over that amount, he's not saying it's safe.
But how do you reconcile that with his unconditional statement in the conclusion that he finds they are safe, and the fact that there is evidence in this record?
And let me build on that, Mr. McLaughlin, and respond to your question. Your question. I'm looking at the appendix at page 91, which is the start of Commissioner Littell's opinion. And he says, the record is clear that there is some credible evidence that there may be health effects associated with significant exposure to RF-EMF, but credible evidence of possible effect does not demonstrate the law court's requisite credible threat of harm to CMP's customers, nor an unsafe utility service.
And again, I think you cannot understand Commissioner Littell's conclusions without reviewing and understanding his findings.
Isn't that argument from that point on really an argument to the fact finder? I mean, you're evaluating the probative force of the various studies that were used by the commission. And the bottom line that was reached by both commissioners was that there was not a credible threat of harm to the health and safety of customers or to others.
From typical exposures. Commissioner, in
this appellate posture, you agree that that's a very substantial burden for you to try to overcome?
I'm not sure. Could you rephrase the question?
In other words, to show that there's an absence of any substantial evidence to support the conclusion that both commissioners reached.
I agree, Your Honor, but I think the findings solve that problem.
But doesn't the approach you're urging stand the appellate review standard on its head? What we're looking at is whether there is substantial evidence, substantial content in the record to support the commission's decision. If there is, then we need to affirm. What you're saying is, wow, there's a lot of evidence to the contrary here suggesting that there is a threat.
I'm not suggesting evidence. I'm suggesting firm, clear findings issued by the decision maker based on the facts. He made findings of fact. You would have to, I believe, undo his findings of fact by going in and making your own findings in order to get around those specific determinations.
You're urging us then to take the conclusion reached by both commissioners that there is not a credible threat of harm to the health and safety of customers and others, and just discount that and say that that's not really
what
they really meant.
No, I'm asking you to understand the meaning of that based on the findings made by the decision makers. I mean, there's a 40-page decision there by Commissioner Littell. It's not meaningless.
Thank you, Mr.
Thank you.
Mr. McCollum?
Thank you, Your Honor. And may it please the court. 3 years ago, this court directed the Public Utilities Commission to conduct a proceeding to determine whether the wireless electric meters, or smart meters, used by Central Maine Power are safe within the meaning of 35A MRS Section 101. The court also provided some guidance to the commission with regard to that proceeding. First, the court framed the safety determination as whether smart meters pose a, quote, credible threat to the health and safety of CMP's customers, unquote. It was with this standard in mind that the commission undertook its investigation. In addition, the court provided some procedural guidance, stating that, quote, although the commission may not have the technical expertise necessary to conduct an independent investigation on this issue, the commission's orders appear to recognize that other state and federal agencies do. As an administrative body authorized to engage in fact-finding, The commission is not precluded from considering the findings and conclusions of other state and federal agencies, unquote. Here as well, the commission took seriously the court's direction and commenced an in-depth fact-finding investigation. Over the course of 2.5 years, the commission held hearings both for the public to express their views and to examine witnesses, conducted and oversaw discovery on and by the parties, received expert and lay testimony, examined thousands of pages of scientific studies, examined how smart meters operate, and reviewed the findings and conclusions of other governmental agencies. Ultimately, the commission determined that CMP smart meters do not pose a credible threat to the health and safety of CMP's customers and are, therefore, safe. The commission's finding is in complete accord with the federal agency tasked with ensuring the safety of wireless communications devices, the FCC, and in complete accord with every state and federal body or agency that has examined this issue. I'm happy to answer any questions that you may have.
We all know that, I assume we know, that RF transmissions at high levels can produce what we're calling thermal harm. So we know these things can cause damage. And the question before us now is, okay, does this particular device, the smart meter, pose a credible threat of harm? If we know that the dose at this level is harmful, but the jury's kind of out down here, we don't have a whole lot of maybe hard science here, wouldn't the more prudent approach would be to say that the burden shifts to CMP or the manufacturers of the devices to say, prove that they're safe? Isn't that the more prudent and safe approach that the commission should be taking?
Well, that's a difficult burden, Your Honor. What that essentially requires is that CMP prove the absolute absence of any possible risk.
But didn't the commission also say that there are inconsistencies in some areas of the research that could be resolved with further research, meaning now as opposed to waiting for science to evolve in the future?
Well, absolutely, Your Honor. Science does evolve in the future. I'm not sure
but
I answered the question.
I'm sorry. I'm drawing off of the conclusion that it poses no credible threat of harm. And in conjunction with that, they note two things. One is that their conclusion is based upon the current state of science. However, they also say that there are inconsistencies in some areas of the research that could be resolved with further research, meaning it could be looked at harder now based on the science that we have now if the research were examined further. Does that impugn the substantive evidence, substantial evidence piece, to support the conclusion of the credible threat?
No, Your Honor, I don't think it does. I mean, the commission has to accept the state of science as it is, and as the state of science that is presented.
No, I understand that, but they're not talking about the state of science when they are saying that the research had some inconsistencies and could be resolved, meaning it could have been better research now. Isn't that the inference from that statement?
It could be, Your Honor, but it hasn't been. And the commission is not a scientific agency. I mean, the commission cannot undertake to study.
So should the uncertainty then go in favor of the utility? And what I'm asking another way is, we all know that strychnine is toxic. If we take a certain amount of it, we will die. But theoretically, that could be watered down to the point where you could take a diffused level and suffer no adverse consequences. It's the argument about the dose. You're familiar with that argument there. So we know that there's a dose of RF frequencies that can be harmful. We can argue that there's a dose of RF frequencies that maybe has no damaging effect at all. Somewhere in that continuum, there's a tipping point. If we don't know that tipping point, should the PUC favor the public or the utility in making that decision as to where that presently unknown cutoff point is? Shouldn't safety trump?
Well, Your Honor, I don't think we have to know where the tipping point is. I think what the commission concluded is that wherever the tipping point is, smart meters are orders of magnitude below it.
Well, but let me challenge you on that. I'm at page 105 of the appendix where there is a reference by the commissioner to the World Health Organization and one of the cancer research authorities indicating that there is persuasive evidence of a possible risk. And that is what we are all looking at. What is the possible risk? There is fairly clearly from this record an acknowledgement that there is risk, and that the risk will be increased both with proximity and dosage, and yet we don't know all of the answers yet. Why isn't it then incumbent upon the commission to say, while this risk remains unknown, we can't be persuaded that it's safe?
Well, Your Honor, I think this goes back to Justice Mead's point a little bit about, you know, it is all about the dosage here. It is all about the exposure level. The studies that the WHO and the IARC have used are cell phone studies. They are studies of much greater intensity.
And let's talk about that for a minute. What becomes clear from the record, if you step back, is that scientists will now tell us there is a measurable level of risk with cell phones that are held to the head, and we now are beginning to see the outcome of those risk studies. We know that the risk here may be less because of the dosage issue, but do we know that in fact the threat of harm is less?
Well, Your Honor, I think we do. Even Mr. Friedman's own expert testified that he found no risk, no increased risk for brain tumors in subjects using cellular phones in a car with an external antenna. So even the complainant's own experts concede that the risk is less.
I hesitate to challenge the chief scientific knowledge, but there is no consensus among the scientific community that there actually is a risk of harm from cell phones. There is some evidence of a possible risk of harm.
Correct, Your Honor.
But there is no consensus with regard to an actual harm.
Correct, Your Honor.
Okay.
And Ms. McCollum, the difference is with whether it's cell phone, microwaves, cordless phones, Wi-Fi, is that the public has the right to choose. They don't have to purchase those items. But here we're talking about a regulated industry, almost like a monopoly, where people don't have a choice. Some people like to buy organic. They don't like to buy processed food. They have a choice. But here, to make that choice, they actually have to pay.
Well, yes, sir.
Isn't that the problem here? So why should the consumer be subjected to any risk if they don't have the option of not purchasing it?
Well, Your Honor, I think we don't want to conflate the sort of economic argument with the risk argument. I mean, the relative price of something doesn't have bearing on whether or not that thing is any more or less
safe. I raise the issue because there's a great deal of discussion throughout the decisions comparing the cell phone, and it's not a series of cell phones, and they haven't outlawed cell phones or microwaves or Wi-Fi.
Correct.
But the difference is the consumers had a choice, which they don't necessarily have, unless there's a cost associated with it, with these smart meters. That's the difference. And there is a significant difference, isn't there, to the consumer?
Well, the choice is still there, Your Honor. The cost is, again, the cost is an economic and more of a policy decision about who should bear the cost that's associated with people opting out of the smart meter system. And the commission has chosen, as a matter of policy, that cost not be socialized among all C&P customers. But the customers that are creating that cost are the ones that should have to pay for it. So, you know, if a customer does not want to have a smart meter, they do not have to have a smart meter. They can opt out, and
so
they
long
pay
as they
cost.
Can afford not to have a smart meter.
May I respond briefly?
You may.
Yes, Your Honor, but the commission has also instituted low-income programs for folks who may be less able to afford smart meters.
Thank you, Mr. Clark. Mr. Farber.
One moment, Your Honor, I'll switch mics. Good afternoon. May it please the court.
So, Mr. Farber, your argument is that the FCC standards are the be-all and end-all of the inquiry. If there's compliance and satisfaction, compliance with and satisfaction of the FCC standards, that's game, set, and match. But with Commissioner Littell's observations that those standards are outdated and need to be subject for further investigation and research, I mean, why is that the case?
Well, the FCC actually is in the process of revisiting its RF standards.
So should the PUC have paused until that is complete?
No, the other point though, the FCC in initiating this rulemaking has acknowledged as well that they're comfortable that the standards that are in place are adequate to protect the public health. Given the fact that there are more recent standards that have been established throughout the world.
Well, if they're that comfortable that they have confidence in the safety of these devices, then why is it that they are investing the resources and spending the time to update the research?
There was a request to the department to investigate, and it's not unusual for departments to continually re-examine the standards that they've set to ensure that the public health is protected. In this case, however, when we look at smart meters, it's clear that the level of emissions that are coming from smart meters are orders of magnitude below the levels that are being considered as health concerns for other devices. We're similar to baby monitors. We're similar to car door openers. This is not the same level of exposure that one would get from other devices.
But one of the problems with the FCC rules is that they have not even considered the non-thermal effects, which may, in fact, be real.
Your Honor, I have to challenge that comment. The FCC, when it established its rule back in 1997, actually did look at non-thermal effects. And in fact, in the cellular telephone task force case in 2000, they acknowledged in that case that, in fact, non-thermal effects were addressed. The National Council of Radiation Protection and Measurements made a statement that the existence of non-thermal effects is clouded by a host of conflicting reports and opinions. And ANSI, the American National Standards Institute, also noted that no reliable scientific data exists indicating that non-thermal exposure may be meaningfully related to human health. That was considered when the FCC established its rulemaking back in 1997.
18 years ago.
And the reality is the data hasn't changed all that much since then. It continues to be evaluated, but there is still that level of uncertainty. And as the Second Circuit said in the cellular telephone case, this is really a balancing issue. Public policy, the setting of health-based standards is a public policy decision. And it evaluates risks of harm versus other benefits of products. And the FCC...
What is the benefit to the public of the smart meters? I understand the benefit to CMP, but if we're balancing benefits, what's the benefit to the public?
The benefit to the public is enhanced service from Central Maine Power. We can, as we've said in our, when we requested permission from the commission to adopt our smart meters, we're able to service customers faster, we're able to respond in storms faster, we're able to...
In other words, you get all the data in real time about the usage. It's
exactly. And customers...
Insight into their house.
Exactly. And customers in the future are going to be able to benefit from that as well as we get more smart devices within homes.
Well, I'm glad you raised that, because as we get more smart devices, do we not get to a point where the cumulative effect is something that has to be considered by the scientists?
And that is something that the scientists consider all the time. It's considered by the FCC when they're setting their standards, the concept of cumulative impacts. When these items are certified as meeting the FCC standards, they undergo a rigorous testing protocol.
Littell, in his opinion, stated very clearly that he thought the FCC standards were out of date and noted that they are opening up another inquiry to look into these standards, right?
Correct.
But why should we say we'll go by whatever the FCC says?
because the FCC is in the best position, and the reality is we are preempted, the commission is preempted under federal law from addressing this and adopting a more stringent standard. That's the essence of conflict preemption. If the commission were to adopt a more stringent standard at this point, where the FCC has a standard in place, that creates a clear conflict.
Thank you, Mr. Carter. Mr. McLaughlin, anything in rebuttal?
Yes, ma'am.
McLaughlin, isn't the real challenge here the standard of review? The commission made its decision. We have to find that there's nothing in the record that would support the decision it made.
I agree with that as far as Commissioner Benoit's decision. Commissioner Littell made very specific findings that are incorporated. Yes, there's a short order where he says safety, but his analysis is incorporated into his joinder there.
Does the law require that the commissioners agree to the reasons for a decision or just to the ultimate outcome?
I don't think that, no, they don't. But his joinder in that decision is irrational. It makes no sense unless you look get there by his legal, his errors of law, and by relying on insufficient evidence. He says typical smart meters are safe. CMP did not prove with any reliable evidence what exposures there are to typical smart meters. They relied on an unrepresentative, statistically invalid sample of 1,100 meters. Typical, according to Dr. Skolnikov, is 234 transmissions per day. There are some that go up to 170,000.
Don't we have to defer to the PUC on a lot of this technical stuff? Don't they have the expertise in this area that we don't, and the law requires us to defer?
You have to look at whether or not their evidence is reliable. If their witnesses testified that they needed a statistical study to make a valid conclusion, and their engineers testified that the study was not statistically valid, then that is completely unreliable. The bottom line is we presented extensive evidence of a proof of harm, proof of a threat of harm, and Commissioner Littell found so. CMP has not proven that their exposures are above the level of the proof of threat of harm that we have presented to the commission. The risk of the uncertainty has to go to CMP.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Farber, this is your first appearance before the law court. You may be aware it's our tradition to invite you and other counsel into chambers so we can welcome you to appellate practice. We'll see you soon.
All right. Where do you read that?